And if you got a Bible, turn with me to the famous passage of Scripture known as the Lord's Prayer, Matthew chapter 6, and we're just going to read it really quick and dissect one more little verse, one more little passage in the Lord's Prayer. Today we are in part 4 of a collection of sermons that we've entitled, Teach Us to Pray. Actually, it's not our title, it's the words of the disciples to Jesus. And today we're believing that God is going to help us pray a little bit more. Amen? Anyone interested in learning how to pray a little bit more, a little bit better? Anyone? Anyone? Come on, 1, 2, 3, 4. Amen. That's enough for me. Let's read it together, old school style. You ready for it? It's coming up on the screens, and some of you should do it with your eyes closed. I'll read the first part, and you start with Our Father. You ready? Then this is how you shall pray. Our Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Today, I actually don't want to talk about that very much. I actually want to talk about the phrase that comes after that, which is a little part that says, give us this day our daily bread. Amen. Father, we thank you for your word. Speak to us. Let it transform us, mold us, God, into the men and women that you have created us to be. God, I pray that as we think about you, talk about you. God, I pray that you would open up the eyes of our heart, Lord, to get a better revelation of who you are. God, I pray that every single individual in this room today, or perhaps tuning in online, God, that we would leave this moment transformed, leave this moment with a greater awareness of your grace, of your goodness, of your power. Lord, I pray, Lord, that you'd give us a holy discontent, Holy Spirit, to not go through life without tapping into a real relationship with you, Father. Transform us today, we ask, and while we are at it, as we always do, as is the custom of our house, we lift up the Miami Dolphins. Have mercy, in Jesus' name we pray. And all of God's people said? Come on, all of God's people said? Amen. Come on, if you love Jesus, is he worthy of your praise? Just give him one more round of applause. Amen. Amen. I grew up with a mother that, to me, she is the definition of a prayer warrior. She came to church last week, and it was good to have her in the building with us, and my parents are pastors of a local Brazilian Spanish church in Coral Springs, and it was good to have them home with us. But every time I think of a prayer warrior, my mind goes to my mom. And I grew up waking up at around 4 o'clock. It's always 4 o'clock. I don't know why. 4 o'clock is like when the Holy Spirit speaks to people, I think, or intercessors, you know? So if this night for your alarm accidentally rings or it's 4 o'clock, you wake up, it's the Lord. Amen? But nevertheless, I grew up like 4 o'clock hearing noises coming from the spare room that was next to my room of my mom crying out to God on behalf of perhaps somebody who was dealing with cancer, battling cancer. I remember vividly, you know, mornings when I would wake up with my mom crying out that God would protect us and her three boys, that God would direct us. I remember my mom crying out on behalf of her friends' kids that perhaps were far away from God and in drugs. I've heard my mom cry out like for years that her brother, her youngest brother, would get saved. Her younger brother was addicted to cocaine from the age of 11, and he got saved by the grace of God. I've heard my mom literally call fire down from heaven is what it seemed like. I grew up with a prayer warrior, and it's really shaped a lot of my thinking. It shaped a lot of my belief in God's word because of what I saw my mom do consistently. But in particular, my mom is sweet, and she's amazing. But my mom, like, she's like She needs Jesus in a lot of areas of her life as well, you know? In particular, I would go from hearing my mom cry out to God to essentially heal somebody that was sick to that same day, perhaps a Saturday, we would get in the car and we would drive to the mall. And as we pulled up to the Macy's parking lot, it's where she liked to go, I heard the same woman asking God for a slab of concrete so she wouldn't have to walk too far from the entrance. And I can remember being like, Mom, are you okay? Like, this morning I heard you pray that, you know, that one dude who's like in a gang now to get saved, and now you have the audacity to ask Jesus Almighty, who's trying to here to save the world, for a slab of concrete at Town Center Mall just so you can save an additional 40 yards from the entrance? Are you kidding me? I'm just kidding. I was way too young to be that cynical. But if she did that to me now, I promise you I would have that thought. But I was thinking about this story, this kind of childhood of mine this week, and I started just asking the question. But seriously, what are the guidelines to what we can pray? Like, what can we ask? What can't we ask? Like, what's worth praying for and what's just life, you know? Does it really matter? Does what matter to me actually matter to God? Wow. Oftentimes, I find myself asking, does Jesus actually care about the Miami Dolphins? I hope so. Yeah, he does. Literally, the Holy Spirit told me that he cares about the Dolphins, he just doesn't care about the Patriots. Amen? Praise God. You know, does Jesus actually care about parking spaces, you know? And oftentimes, I can hear my son Rivers learning how to pray now, and Maverick just copies what his brother says, and before bed we pray, and sometimes the prayers are just like so shallow, and they're just so like, did you just really pray for your Hot Wheel? You know, like, I don't get it. Like, come on, son. Like, you're a PK. You know, you should pray for the big stuff, you know? And oftentimes I can hear prayers and I can just think to myself, man, those just sound shallow. And as I was preparing to preach this message, I kind of did a deep dive in what the Bible has to say about prayer. And in particular, one scholar says that there's prayer in every page of the Bible. Not preaching. Not fill in the blank. It's prayer. And what's interesting is small requests can often seem so shallow, but as I studied prayer, I opened up my Bible to Genesis, the first time where we see prayer. The first time we see prayer is when Adam and Eve are, the Bible calls, talking to God in the cool of the evening, in the cool of the garden. And in particular, as you diagnose that reality, Adam and Eve talking to God in the cool of the garden, what you will come to the conclusion in seeing is that prayer has been around long before problems have been around. Prayer precedes even problems. There was prayer before there was disease. There was prayer before there was divorce. There was prayer before there was depression. There was prayer before there was any catastrophic injury. There was prayer before there was death. So, like, what was Adam and Eve talking to God about? I don't know, maybe they were talking to God about the trees. You know, hey, God, you did a really good job with this coconut tree, man. Great job. Maybe, you know, they were probably like, can we really eat the strawberry? Can we eat star fruit? That's what I would ask God. And I feel like I'm going to die every time I eat a star fruit, you know? Is it poisonous? I'm actually like 99% sure of this. I imagine every single morning when Adam rolled over and he looked at Eve, he said a prayer. He said, God, is our breath always going to stink in the morning? You know, but it's interesting. These deep stuff, you know? But what's interesting is that from the beginning of time, it just appears like the prayers were small compared to the prayers that we have to pray today. To which I came to this conclusion, and it's coming up on the screens, and it's this: there is no such thing as shallow prayers, only shallow people. And the reality that I want to communicate with you today is just like there is a shallow end to a pool and there's a deep end to the pool, yes, God wants you to progress in your prayer life. He wants you to yearn and long for matters that are beyond you and beyond your limited understanding of life in the world as we perceive it with our natural eyes. God wants us to go into the metaphorical deep end. But what I find in Scripture is that it's okay if you're in the shallow end as well. The conclusion that I have come to reading the Bible is that God doesn't care if the prayer is shallow or the prayer is deep. God just wants you in the pool. God just wants you communicating. God just wants you praying. God just wants you to be in dependence of Him in the shallow end, and He also wants you to go into the deep where you lose your control and you need to rely on Him for even greater and bigger things. God just wants you in the pool of prayer. And in particular, today we find ourselves again in this passage of Scripture known as the Lord's Prayer. And the Lord's Prayer is beautiful. And in particular, we're talking about the little part that says, "Give us this day our daily bread." So if you're taking notes today, the title of my message is simply Daily Bread. And in particular, daily bread is what we call petition prayer. Petition prayer. Somebody say petition? Prayer. Petition prayer. The first week we talked about abiding prayer. Abiding in the love of the Father. That's where you got to start. You don't enter into His throne room as a servant. You enter into His throne room as a child of God. You can come with your sleeves rolled up, ready to do whatever God has for you. But before God deploys you into assignment, He just wants you to be with Him. And then we talked about in week 2 and in week 3 about intercessory prayer, standing in the gap for people and praying the will of God over the brokenness of humanity. And today we find ourselves in the category of petition. And last week in particular, I shared a joke. And you guys didn't do so well. You didn't laugh like I wanted you to laugh. So if you'd humor me, I'm going to, you know, tell you the joke again. Is that all right? Yeah. One day, KFC, the head of KFC, called the Pope in the Vatican and said, "Pope, sir, KFC is willing to give you $1 million if you change the Lord's Prayer from give us this day our daily bread to give us this day our daily chicken." Pope said no. Called back the next day, $10 million. No. Called back the next day, said fine, $100 million. He says, "You have a deal." And they signed a deal, and the Pope changed it to give us this day our daily chicken, which pollo in some cases. And he got all of his, you know, big wigs, all the leaders around the table, and he sat around. He said, "Guys, Mother Teresa, ladies, nuns, whatever, sisters, good news, bad news. Good news is we're $100 million richer." And they celebrated. "Bad news, we lost the Wonder Bread account." Good enough for me. Good enough for me. But how insane is this prayer? In the middle of a ultra-reverent prayer, a prayer that God, that Jesus teaches us to utter, "Our Father who art in heaven," a prayer that is as cosmic as "Your kingdom come, Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven," as contrite and brokenhearted and poor in spirit, as "Forgive us of our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us," as spiritual warfaric, I just made up a word, as spiritual warfaric, as "Deliver us from the evil one." God, through Jesus Christ, has the audacity to insert in there a prayer that is so simple, so shallow, so small, so unavoidably practical as, "Oh, and while you're at it, give us this day our daily bread." Now, don't get me wrong. The progression of your prayer matters, if you let me just teach you for something really quick. The progression of your prayer, if you're going to pray the way that Jesus prayed, matters. Notice how Jesus doesn't teach us to go to Him and just ask Him for His attention on our problem right away. Jesus' intention when He taught us the Lord's Prayer is He doesn't want prayer to be like the same thing as opening up your Amazon app. What do I want today? What's on sale today, Jesus? No. But when Jesus teaches us to pray, He teaches us the first thing you've got to do is you've got to go from your temporary, limited, burdened reality, and you have to shift to the reality of the Father, the limitless God. You have to shift your perspective, shift your reality from your limited understanding to an infinite reality of the goodness of God. And in particular, when you do that shift, what you find is yourself giving God your attention. Now, here's another thing you ought to write this down. Because a lot of you want to know what God wants from you. Here's what He wants most from you. The thing God desires most is your attention. Not your money, which, by the way, is not yours in the first place. We'll talk about that a different day. Not your talent. Not God wants your attention. The greatest thing you can give to God is your undivided attention. That's why the greatest thing that the enemy attacks in your life is ultimately designed to distract you from God. That's why prayer is so dang hard. You start praying. If you're anything like me and you're praying before you know it. I'm like looking at that window. It's like, there's somebody there. Is that a squirrel? What is that noise? Oh, why is the stage like this? Oh, this light burned. Oh, man. Wait, prayer. God, thank you for your grace, your goodness. God wants your attention. But what's beautiful about this is that the Lord's Prayer, it tells us God's will with the pronouns. If you see the first start of the Lord's Prayer, the pronoun is your, our, your, which in particular, the Lord's Prayer is teaching us to align our mind, to get a holy imagination. Jesus starts there, but he doesn't stay there. Jesus essentially is trying to get you to give him your attention. Listen closely to this. So that your perspective can be altered. I love that one verse in the Psalm that says this, delight in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. I love that verse. I used to always think the best part about that verse was the part of the desires. I want a new house. I want this. I want this. The best part of that about that verse is not that you get your desires. It's that you get God. It's that your delight goes from the things of this world. Your desires get purified so that your greatest delight is not found in your bank account. It's not found in relationships, but it's found in the presence of Jesus. It's found in you giving your attention to a God that is incredibly in love with you, a God that doesn't just call you to be his servant, but he calls you to be his child. The greatest thing about that verse is when you find your delight, your greatest satisfaction in the simple presence of God Almighty. And essentially, he's teaching us to first set our attention on him. And I love what Pastor Jim Cimbala, the pastor of Brooklyn Tabernacle, also the author of my favorite book, Fresh Wind, Fresh Fire. Look what he says. He says, faith, it's coming up on the screens, never denies reality. So when you go from your reality to his reality, faith never denies reality, but leaves room for God to grant new realities. So when you go from this perspective, it's like as if you go up in a high rise. You go up on a high rise, and now before you know it, the car that was big, the semi-truck that was big, now it's minute. It's significantly smaller in comparison to the height, the depth, the power of the grace and goodness of God. It elevates your perspective, and from there you get the proper vantage point. God wants you to elevate your vantage point by turning your attention to him. And from there it goes from your to us. And now, as you find yourself within the reality of God's power, goodness, and mercy, from there, you invite God into your reality. What's your reality this morning? Just lost your job? Going through depression? What's your reality this morning? Looking for guidance? What's your reality this morning? Perhaps you feel like you're going through the rat race of life, and time is passing, and things are going good, but when you lay your head down at night, you're like, am I really fulfilled? Am I really doing what God has called me to do? Am I leaving some things out? Am I leaving potential on the table? What's your reality today? Well, regardless of your reality today, when you find yourself within the reality of the goodness and grace and power of God, you then are invited, you then are instructed by Jesus Christ in the Lord's Prayer to invite Jesus and his power into your reality, regardless of what it is. The Lord's Prayer essentially can be summed up to what Eugene Peterson says, which is this: prayer involves us deeply and responsibly in all of the operations of God. But then, prayer also involves God deeply and transformatively in the details of our everyday life. We go from God's reality, we invite him into our reality. And his desire is to be, just in case you are wondering today, God's desire is to be intricately involved in every aspect of your life. But what I love about God is this, that everything he invites us to, he's not just inviting us into something to essentially do something for us, give us something. But when God invites us into something, his intention is to mold us and shape us. His intention is to reform us, to rearrange us, to reorient us, to essentially shed light in the things that actually matter. God is attempting to align our life in the right angle and perspective. So here it is. Prayer doesn't always change what is happening around you, but prayer can change what's happening within you. Why should I pray? Why do I ask? Let me give you three reasons really quick. One, the first thing why you should add petition, why you should pray about everything and anything often is this, because first things first, petition prayer, it stimulates and it propels you into a life of first gratitude. Somebody say gratitude.
Gratitude.
You see, while you're judging the woman for praying for a slab of concrete at Macy's, your heart, Bennett Johnson, is getting more cynical. It's getting more bitter. You're getting more religious. Ugh. You're getting more ego. You're getting more self-righteous. While her heart is overwhelming with gratitude. Because you know what my mommy always did? Every time she got that parking space, she says, you see, I'm a daughter of God. Thank you, Jesus. I'm like, you're so corny, you know? While my heart is growing cynical, her heart is getting grateful. You see, if you pray about everything, we get to give God thanks more often. Resulting in more gratitude. And gratitude is the reward of those who dare to pray for everything. Gratitude is the reward of those who dare to pray for everything. And here's what's really beautiful about gratitude, is that gratitude, people who are grateful, genuinely, authentically grateful. Here it is. Gratitude is an indication that peace rules the heart. Grateful people, that's an indication that there is overwhelming peace ruling their heart. You see, Paul says it like this in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 18. Be thankful in all circumstances, for this is the will of God, for you who belong to Christ Jesus. You ought to be grateful. I love what Ronald, this ancient writer, says. Look what he says. This is profound. He says this, to be a saint is to be filled by gratitude. Nothing more, nothing less. And here it is. Here's the one that really got me. Only one kind of person transforms the world spiritually. Someone with a grateful heart. And you see, petition is the pathway to gratitude. When we pray the way Jesus taught us to pray, the result of that, that common every day, as common as daily bread, what happens is we put one foot in front of the other in the pathway to a heart that is overflowing with gratitude. And gratitude is power in the kingdom of God. But you see, the second thing that happens when you allow petition to be the result of your life is you go from gratitude, but then God begins to deal with your demonic, distorted desire for control. Control. Petition is a declaration of war against the Spirit's worst enemy. One of the Spirit's worst enemies. One of the Spirit's worst enemies is control. You see, the result of control, the reality of control, is that control, this desire to want to be in control, it derives from a healthy desire. It's a desire for fruitfulness. It's a desire for productivity. Who wants to be productive? Who wants to be fruitful? Anyone just want to know who I'm talking to? Anyone have ambitions in their heart today? You see, that is a healthy, God-given desire. God has given you a yearning and a longing to pursue productivity. Just so you know, people who are bored are not living in the will of God. God walks with those who are walking. God moves with those who are moving. But I've never seen God sit with those who are sitting. You know what I mean by that? I've never seen God answer the prayers of a bored person. But when you roll up your sleeve and say, God, I'm going to steward what you've given me, what I see is God's provision, God's the wind of heaven blowing at their back. So get productive, get working, get moving, don't retire. Find something else to do. But here it is. This healthy desire for productivity when it gets unbalanced, it turns into this longing to always be in control all of the time. And before you know it, you have this beautiful desire. Now you've essentially allowed this overwhelming sense of, I want to be in control of everything. I want to be in control of everything. I want to be in control of everything. And you grab the wheel. You know, you don't do what Carrie Underwood teaches you to do and let Jesus take the wheel, but you take the wheel of your own life. I love those jokes, you know? It's like, bad. You take the wheel of your own life, and before you know it, what begins to rise is anxiousness, worry, stress, and worst of all, when you are trying to get in control of everything, the worst thing that happens is that your ego begins to elevate. And you know what ego stands for, right? You begin to edge God out. I got this. I got this. This is always a humbling reality for me. And the way I try to protect my mind from always trying to be in control and actually be independent of God, I always remember this one story my mom taught me. And the story was in regards to preaching. This young guy went to go preach at a church one day, and the young guy climbed up the stairs with his chest all out, and he got up the stairs, and he preached this message, and it was awful. It was horrible. And then he walked down the stairs just defeated. And a sweet little old lady from the church went up to him and said, "Son, if you went up the way you went down, you would have gone down the way you went up. You went down self-sufficient. You went down God-reliant. If you go up God-reliant, God won't make you self-sufficient, but he will give you a supernatural, God-infused confidence that you will know come hell or high water. If he be for you, nothing can stand against you. Come whatever, he is your source, he is your strength, and he will give you a supernatural confidence. But you see, control is not your responsibility. Courage to trust him is. And when you allow God to assembly, when you allow petition, asking for every little thing, when you allow that pattern of prayer in your life, what begins to happen is that God begins to detox out of your body this desire, out of your spirit, out of your mind, a desire to always be in control. And let me just warn you right now, you know when you're detoxing from something, your body begins to beg for it? You know what I'm saying? When you do a liquid fast, your body's like, give me steak. And you get it. We can talk about this all day long. But when your body is going, when your soul is going through a detox of being out of control, what your soul begins to beg for is more control. And your soul will ask the question, why do I have to ask anyways? Why do I have to be so dependent anyways? Come on, why do I have to wait on God? I can roll up my own sleeve and muster this up in myself. And God is the God that wants you to ask so that you can remain dependent. You see, these two little words, give us, or better yet, give me, are my boy's favorite words. It's a childish word. But that's how God wants your life to be. Lord, give me a parking space. Lord, give me fill in the blank. That's good. You see, but why do we have to ask when he already knows what we want? Because he wants control to get eradicated from your heart. All throughout Scripture, we find this. Blind Bartimaeus, a guy who was blind he was blind all of his life. The Bible says that one day Jesus walks up to him and Jesus asks him, look, it's coming up on the screens. Mark 10:51. What do you want me to do? Jesus asked. What do you mean? What do you want him to do? He's been blind from birth. Jesus, heal. The blind man replied, I want to see. I love this one part, this one story. This one man was lame. He couldn't walk for 38 years. And there was this legend in Israel next to this pool known as the Pool of Bethesda. And they believed that every time the water bubbled up, the first person to jump in the water, they would get healed. So this man was laying on the mat all of these years waiting for the water to boil up so he can jump in and be healed. Jesus shows up on a scene one day, and look at that, John 5:6. It says, when Jesus saw him lying there, and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked, do you want to get well? What? Is that a rhetorical question? My favorite one, though, is John 2. The wine runs out. Somebody say, uh-oh. Y'all need Jesus up in here, you know? The wine runs out, and Jesus' mom goes to him. When the wine had gone out, Jesus' mother said to him, there's no more wine. And he said, woman, why do you involve me? Like, I don't care. What do you want me to do? My hour has not yet come. In other words, Jesus knows what you want, and Jesus knows what you need, but he still wants you to ask. He still wants petition to be an added element to your prayer life so that control can be relinquished and trust can be elevated. Because here's what I'll tell you. Dependency, it is a weakness in the eye of the world, but dependency is viewed as strength in the eyes of the kingdom of God. Weakness and dependency might be weakness in America, but we don't abide with the kingdom of America. We live in the kingdom of heaven. So God, make me poor in spirit. God, give me everything that I need. Dependency is where God wants you to be. But then, the third thing that God will do, he will stimulate gratitude. He will eradicate control. But then God will essentially, as you develop a prayer life of petitioning, asking for kingdom come and daily bread, you essentially will get a greater level of relationship with him. You see, you can't build relationship without asking. Because asking leads to what? Vulnerability. Vulnerability leads to what? Trust. Some of you, your prayer life is so, I don't want to say shallow because that's not bad, but your prayer life is so limited to only the big stuff, or perhaps your prayer life is so limited, let's call it limited. It's so limited that you make no room for God to disappoint you, let alone surprise you. And God's ultimate end game is relationship with his children. It's relationship with his children. Now as Hugo come up, keys come up, and I'm almost done. It's hot as fish grease in here. I think this AC is not working. It's not why I'm wrapping up. I'm trying to get you home. It's okay. You see, the thought pattern of petition is such a deep matter of the heart. Because how you feel about asking God for every little thing is directly connected to how you actually see God. Let me say that again. Your perspective on asking God for every little thing, however you feel about it, good or bad, it's directly connected to your theology, your perception, your thought about God. Let me ask you this question. When you picture God, what do you see? When you picture the face of God, what expression does he have on? Is he angry? Is he mad? I love what Julianne of Norwich said. She says it like this. God's face, completely relaxed and courteous. He was himself the happiness and peace of his dear friends. His beautiful face, radiating measureless love, like a marvelous symphony. Jesus, he's got a smile on. Jesus is saying, child, kingdom come, daily bread, whatever it is, I want you to ask because my end game with you is real relationship. You see, the Lord's Prayer is actually a common prayer of Jesus' day. It's a famous Jewish prayer known as the Kadesh. So Jesus was essentially, he was just praying what God had already taught the people how to pray anyways. But let me read to you the Kadesh really quick. The Kadesh says it like this. It's coming up on the screens. And I want you to really pay attention and do a compare and contrast with the Lord's Prayer and the Kadesh. Gratified and sanctified be God's great name throughout the whole world, which he has created according to his will. May he establish his kingdom in your lifetime, during your days, within the line of the entire house of Israel. Speedily and soon, and say amen. May his great name be blessed forever and to all eternity, blessed and praised, glorified and exalted, extolled and honored, adored and laud, be the name of the Holy One. Blessed be He beyond all the blessings and hymns and praises and consolations that have ever been spoken in the world. And again, say amen. May there be abundant peace from heaven and life for us and for all of Israel. Say amen. He who created peace in his celestial heights, may He create peace with us for all Israel. And say again, amen. Essentially, Jesus is talking to Jews. And when Jesus would have said these things, it would have made sense. Oh, is Jesus quoting the Kadesh? Kind of. But what does Jesus add to the Kadesh? Two elements. Instead of using the words God, instead of using the words celestial being, He uses the word Father. And He teaches us not just to ask for the peace of the world, but He teaches us to ask for daily bread. The difference is that Jesus adds relationship to your prayer life. And I'll end with this. I love my job. I'm doing exactly what I want to do. I love it. I love pastoring you. I love everything about it. But there's some days that are heavy. There's some weeks that we go from counseling a couple that is dealing with infidelity and has chosen divorce, and that's a heavy moment. And from there, oftentimes I find myself going to meetings at, you know, homeless nonprofits on how we can serve the homeless population of the region. And then we come back here and we meet with somebody perhaps walking through depression, has had suicidal thoughts. And then there's days that we go from that, and then we deal with, you know, maybe it's a death of a family member, and then we do funerals, and then it's heavy. And there's some days that it's like, my God, the world is jacked up. God Almighty. But every single day, regardless of how heavy the day is, and in particular the days that are really heavy, I do the same thing. 5 o'clock or so rolls around, I close my Bible, I shut off my iPad, I close my laptop, I pack my bag slowly, I zip it, I put it in my bag, I get in my car, I roll down the windows, I turn off the radio, and I live 3 minutes away, but usually days that are heavy, I live 10 minutes away, I go slower. And I just go home, attempting to decompress on my way home. And the moment that I pull into the driveway, literally, I touch the clicker of the garage. The garage hasn't even started opening yet. I touch the clicker, and it's like a sensor goes off in my house. Daddy's home! Daddy's home! Daddy! And the boys run. They kick the door of the garage open, and they run, and they hug Daddy. And then I hold the two of them, and I get inside. It's River Maverick, and then Everett is sitting on the couch, and he sees me, and he gives me a big smile. Have no idea what Daddy, they have zero context for what Daddy just went through, who Mommy and Daddy counseled, that Daddy just did a funeral, and we're playing, and they're tackling me, and at some point, River typically says, Daddy, can I have some ice cream today? He has no idea that Daddy just counseled somebody whose brother committed suicide. He has no idea that Daddy was just in a meeting with somebody who is 11 days sober and is itching to leave the facility. Daddy, can we have ice cream today? Yeah, we can. Chocolate truffle. On sale, 2 for 1 at Publix. You want to go with Daddy? Yeah. That's God. Is He preoccupied with the things of this world? The catastrophic natures of the things happen? Yes. Lord, can I have a parking space at Macy's? Yeah. Why? Because I love you, but I also want gratitude to well up on your heart. I want you to be radically dependent on me for every little nook and cranny of your life. And I want real relationship with you. You see, here's what I want you to know. God is a relational being to know, not a formula to master. He's not a genie on a bottle. He's a person. He is a friend. He is the Father that wants intimacy with you. He wants to know what your burdens are. He wants to know what your pain points are. But he also wants to know, do you want ice cream after church today? Yes. What do you want? He is the loving Father. So here is my last thing for you. Two things. Jim Cimbala said it like this. Anything, I mean anything, becomes a blessing if it drives us to prayer. Anything, I mean anything, becomes a blessing if it drives you to prayer. And the last thing I'll leave you with is Paul's quote, Philippians chapter 4. Do not be anxious about anything. Do not be anxious about anything. But in every situation, by prayer, petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. God does not want you to pray about big things occasionally. He wants you to pray about small things continually. Your kingdom come and daily bread. Amen.